know that I'm standing in between whatever Wednesday night beer is or preference dinner. Actually, this will be a very short talk, but moreover, I would like to hear from you. So my name is Arseny. I do not work for Dell, by the way. I do not work for Dell. I'm a solution architect, and I've been working on some monetary authority of Singapore technology risk guidelines before, like many years ago. They were related to VMware, and I co-authored a comparison to help the, and it's publicly available, to help the industry basically leverage the best practices and map if there is a regulator requirement, how to answer it, or if there is a security team within a big financial organization giving you a hard time, how to answer their questions. So I basically want to do the same for containers for Dockers, and I basically share the digest of open materials that I found around using Google search engine. But I really want to hear from you, because I believe there's a very different crowd today, and I really want to hear what you do. What do you do for security in your organizations? To start with, I'm not a security expert, so don't worry. It's fine. Not a security expert, never been it. And I don't want to boil the ocean. It's really not something that I will be able to do in 20 minutes, so forget about it. So two questions. Who has in their production environment today any test-driven security pipelines? So anyone does test-driven security approaches today? Cool. Who has, okay, before even going to SAT, this acronym from financial markets, who works for insurance or for some regulated enterprise that runs Docker in production? One, two, okay, got it. That's good. That's good for me, because then I cannot screw up that significantly, because everything I do is just assuming my experience and whatnot. So I want to just start with a problem statement. Remember the good old days, we had a very clear demarcation line in between where the developers are and where the operations people are. So the dependencies in here, this is where the gray line is starting to appear with containerization. So who actually keeps an eye on all the dependencies for containers? So within the container, you may have a particular version of Python. Within a container running on the same host, you may have like a plethora of other dependencies. So who has to work on that? So in ideal containerized world, it looks like that you have an application and it has all the prerequisites, all the dependencies installed in it, and everything is beautiful. But then all of a sudden, your guys call you and they say, hey, AppC, we forgot, we actually have a better release, we just migrated it to Java, we want to migrate it to Java, can you just make sure that the image we are building on, the production security image, is right now running like on Java, no longer need all these dependencies, we need it like in 5 minutes. Well, it's a DevOps world, all you do is, what you do is you install the needed prerequisites, update the image of the container, send it back to the rebuild pipeline, everything works fine, nothing breaks. But then they wake up and they say like, oh, by the way, we needed Java 8, we forgot. It actually is like optimized for Java 8. Can you do the same but for Java 8? And you do that. And in the end, the risk is with all these images, you end up with an enormous amount of configuration drift. So you may have like ports open and something listening on those ports and maybe not even patched to the proper levels. And this is how configuration drift could look like for a particular image. It's on koi.io, and they're like Nginx image that has been open and downloaded like 1,000 times. They sent it, and it's been used in multiple projects, as you can imagine, across the universe, across the internet. And there were like 264 medium-level vulnerabilities, 126 high-level vulnerabilities. It's just because everyone just patched it a little bit there, updated the image, and the latest became this huge drift from like where it should have been, right? So, and actually, this is a very interesting slide that I found. So look at this information security job postings. They kind of tend to go down, and DevOps jobs, they kind of tend to go up. So the problem, I guess, will be signified in future. So if we look at the DevOps factory, I'll try to put it in here. This is the usual process. It's a mixed like logical and process state flow diagram of interchange that leads from development of a particular business requirement from business partners or business analysts and all the way into production that is on the operate side and the green side. Do you see anything on this diagram related to security at all? This is DockerConf. This is 2017. It's actually from the keynote of DockerCon 2017 from MetLife, from their presentation. So like a couple of months ago, nothing here says about security. It does mention like, okay, we have a CI/CD tool and magically we do push-pull tag and image scanning. No details, right? So I guess this is the area where we need to at least like put a bookmark to ourselves like, well, we need to research it. Because like not too much of material or best practices are currently in the easy digestible form, how to do that stuff. Yep.
So if you look at, they're using Docker Trusted Registry. If you go to the marketing slides of Docker Trusted
Registry, yeah.
There's a lot about that.
Oh yeah, I actually included one marketing slide later on, but okay. It doesn't actually give you all the best practices how to actually do stuff. So the new realities there's a new term, DevSecOp, developer security operations, right? So the new reality is we have a completely decentralized ownership of deployment. So we need to get as early concerned about security as we can. And we should narrow it down to like an easy digestible tasks all the way through the pipeline and make sure that there is no configuration drift in the image, for example, and make sure that the injection points are designed together with developers so they understand the concern. So they don't come and rush at you and ask you to give them Java 8 and then provoke this configuration drift that can hence give you a lot of vulnerabilities. So at the one-on-one level, how secure is Docker? And these are the kind of conversation that we may have with security guys just over coffee in a big firm or like in a Starbucks if you see someone. So I went into CVE details and opened up what are the current open Docker vulnerabilities. So for a vendor called Docker, there are currently 14 vulnerabilities, some still pending from 2016, not yet patched. It's not too bad, actually. So 14 CVEs, just to give you an anchor point, what is Kubernetes? Kubernetes actually has three. So there are three vulnerabilities currently known to the global population of our planet that are related to Kubernetes. And to give you another anchor point, our favorite product ESXi from the very old days currently have 31 vulnerabilities. So answer is it's quite secure by nature. So Docker and Kubernetes are well built. They are not really vulnerable as they are. How about running in the cloud? So there is a report, and again, I'll share all this materials and digest of the links with you. When you run deployment template for CloudFormation that Docker provides with Docker Cloud, there are five total issues, and two of them are low risk. Basically, there are over-provisioning CloudFormation AIM roles, just with a little bit too much of permissions than needed. So that's not bad. I mean, I would say brilliant, actually. So same for Azure. There was an independent research that gone through recently. This research was published. There are only three issues that are related to rolling out Docker on top of Azure. Very minor issues, again, related to more of like preference rather than a problem. Now, what has to happen? We used to run apps, and again, like I apologize, it's just a digest of multiple different slides, right? We used to run apps through the development into the user acceptance testing, and then we would have sent them to security acceptance tests, which are mandatory part of the DevOps in the old legacy world. So in the bank, for example, security acceptance team would take like a couple of days, then they will call you and they say, dude, this is not working. We're not passing the scans. It used to be like a waterfall approach. Now, they looked for everything. So security acceptance team would have scrutinized all the code that you push into the production. They would have gone and checked every particular source code as well, crawled it for customer data, crawled it for some stored credentials, whatnot. They were acceptable when we did not have to do releases five times an hour. So it's not really what we can do these days with DevOps. So the new analysis for vulnerabilities, the new analysis for security, has to be a bottoms-up one. So we need to identify specific classes per application, like what are the most likely vulnerable areas in this app or in this microservice or in this microservice. And we need to only care about just those. And we need to push it as heavily into elimination of these problems early, before they actually hit even any particular last-minute security tests. We need to push for that in the development pipeline as much as we can. And that would actually support the only way to support, this would be the only way to support the velocity of security. Now, just again, like some tidbits. There are really good security best practices published by Docker themselves. So they talk about the usual things. Usual things, when I'm saying usual things, are the things that regulator, the things that your security officer would actually care about. So like centralized logging. Yes, it's covered in reference architecture. Yes, please do something with CloudWatch. If you do a lot of cloud deployment in AWS, please use the CloudTrail for the API traces as well. In GCP, everything is centralized. It's quite different with Stackdriver. Do the signing of the content if you use the repository. There is this service within Docker that's called Notary. It allows you to create the hashed kind of like snapshots of the code of a particular revision so that there is no tampering, there is no man-in-the-middle substitution. So all these best practices are covered. There's a special, very nice document out there. Now, there is also for the host itself that runs Docker, and that is something that could be incorporated into the security practices within your firm. There is an audit tool that kind of comes as a part of the intrusion prevention scanner. So you run a small container on the worker node itself, and as you can see, it maps into the var runs and into etc. and pulls the usual Linux sockets and figures out, are they configured, the hosts underneath running the containers, the usual host that you have, are they configured as per the best practices against the known latest vulnerabilities? So it's again, like this is part of Docker. There is an audit tool, which is pretty cool. You run it as one command line, and it produces you a report like this. Is your Docker current? Is the Docker audit files are in place? Are you logging into right folders? Do you do like the proper logging level? Is it like only like exceptional or everything that you do, et cetera. Now there's also a separate, and again, like I seek your input. Maybe you can chime in with more tools around it. There's a separate project that could do pretty much the same thing, but both on-prem and in the cloud. And it's called Claire. It's developed by CoreOS team. What it does, it also pulls the vulnerability updates into a small data store, and then it also runs a per layer analysis of your Docker image. So if you actually run it on your, say, version N-2 once, it takes like an hour. But since you've done it on the layer that was N-2, on the N-1, it would only scan for the incremental changes on that layer. So you don't have to redo the entire Docker scan. So you actually significantly reduce the time for the vulnerabilities scan, unless there is something not changed. So take a look at this Claire tool, and it's incorporated in several cloud providers. Security artifacts. This is a pain point, but you probably heard about ransomware for MongoDB that recently hit the entire planet. People did not at all set passwords, but like another problem is when you set passwords, you hard code them. So the good practice, the best practice, is to avoid hard coding and to pass the credential, pass the security artifacts into the running application through environmental variables. And you do that, for example, by setting a -e variable that is then available for your app to pull. So you literally pass something into the container from the outer world when you run it, and then you take it and use it. I mean, this is very simple best practice, but for some reason people especially developing guys, they tend to forget when they push apps, and there are so many bitcoins that are paid to ransomware guys because someone then commits the code to public GitHub, and it's all there. And actually, I've been looking at a lot of resources, there are like some attack vector analysis. It takes like 15 minutes to literally like completely block, especially through Jenkins. And I have a slide on that. So it's insane. Jenkins allows you to crack it through the console if it's not really password protected well. But anyhow, so yes, please pass them through environmental variables. You could also, if you're using AWS EC2 container service, you can pass them in the CloudFormation template. You can define them and use the CloudFormation script to retrieve it from some secure vault or from some other source into the CloudFormation. So even your CloudFormation template that then builds a lot of Docker containers on AWS will not have it hard coded. You just script around getting it from some other location, and yeah, you could retrieve it from the metadata of the instance if you're running on EC2 or Google Cloud. There is an instance you can just curl into the instance metadata from within the app at the bootstrap, and then retrieve the tokens that you need to access other services. Now, another tidbit: the previous speaker actually had it on one of the slides. There is a very interesting startup called Cilium, and Cilium does an additional layer of like tapping into the networks at the packet level. They insert themselves before the virtualized adapters of Docker, and they basically add themselves as a kernel, almost like a kernel module, and they allow packet filtering to the container plane running on the worker node defined in the Berkeley packet filter format. And Berkeley, the BPF system is already adopted by Docker. For example, they allow and deny particular syscalls. So from within a Docker container, by default, there are some syscalls that you cannot run at all. There are like 44 of them banned. For example, you cannot run like mount, or you cannot run the process trace, you cannot reboot the worker nodes from within the container. So they already use this BPF framework in Docker itself. But then there is this Cilium company, and this is their proxy architecture that allows you to basically do the packet filtering and even at L7 on the path level. Do very complex rules to kill the packets, to deny access or to deny traffic to a particular application or not. So it's running as an agent on a Docker node. There is also, they have a project that they insert themselves into Kubernetes kubelet, and they have the monitoring, they have the CLI special hooks that configure this almost like an IP tables routing, IP tables filtering on the packet level. And again, like it's very low latency. It inserts itself as a kernel at the kernel level. So very, very interesting, quite sophisticated startup. There's a very good session about it, about an hour long. So now, yeah, the marketing slides from Docker, Vincent. Docker promotes, and again, anyone works for anyone from Docker here? Anyone works? There's no one from Dell, no one from Docker. The guy from Puppet left. Okay, anyhow. No vendors? So yeah, this is the marketing slide that we discussed. So it looks like everything is running out of the box. Again, I'm not a user of Enterprise Edition of Docker, but they really made a significant effort to add aspects like role-based access control, trusted registry. Trusted registry is your on-site, completely secured, key-managed source for the container images that, avoids man-in-the-middle attacks substituting your app's code. So there is a lot of effort put in place to just run compliance requirements out of the box with Docker Enterprise Edition. RBAC, so you can basically label a particular container or label a particular control group and allow some particular users that are LDAP authenticated, not just the local user that runs Docker, but a particular LDAP user to do some actions against control groups of containers or host themselves. So it's very definable in an enterprise edition of Docker. Nothing like that actually in Kubernetes. You can do similar things somewhat in the cloud, but again, not as granular. Now, the best practices of hardening Linux containers, reducing attack surfaces, very simple, right? Remember the configuration drift story that we started with, like lots of ports that who knows what they're doing there. Attempt to isolate not only as on the development staging or like user acceptance and production, but also on the risk. So try to containerize. This is the best practice. If anyone worked in the bank, there are business criticalities. So you have to go like BC5, the topmost one, like do or die, go fix it. Or BC1, like, okay, let's leave with it. If it's down for 1 week, no one would care about that app. So like do this on the risk, do this on this exposure, and then try to scrutinize the security one by one. So create like a structured tree of decisions. What is my most business critical? What are the exposures? What are the possible attack vectors? Apply and enable all security relevant configuration options. Yes, if you already pay for Docker Enterprise Edition, or if you already have something enabled by default when you install it, do not tamper with it. Keep everything up to date. Back to the gentleman from Puppet. Regularly test security recommendations 1 to 4. So everything you do, put an Outlook calendar, and this is what it's absolutely normal to do. Put an Outlook calendar reminder once in 2 months, just go and just sanity check. Did we change anything? Did we miss anything? Just like a reminder. And remember, complexity breeds insecurity. The more complex, the more sophisticated set of scripts are, the probability that there will be something hard-coded or something that your dev team will inherit from you, and it will breed the attack vector exposure. Now, two very cool talks that I've seen. One was on Enigma, and it's been from a guy who works from Mozilla, and they push as, I don't actually use Firefox to be honest, but they push a lot of releases. Like if you look at them at their release pipeline, it's pretty much a weekly stable or something like that. It's insane. And of course they use the pipeline. So what they do is they define the baseline for their security. So what should be like our central focal point for every release? And of course if they do add-ons, that's much more effort to control add-ons to Firefox because it's a community thing, right? So developer submits an add-on, you have to still like go through the same pipeline because it's part of the dependency release for the core browser. So they write tests and they insert them into their continuous integration, continuous delivery pipeline. So the security baseline for them, for Mozilla browser, is something like that. So they define scores, like what would be the build score for Jenkins to use. And like they need to pass, some may fail, some have to pass. They define the baseline. They write test using ZAP, and it's called ZAttack. Here we go. It's called ZAttack. Oh, actually, I deciphered it. I forgot. Sorry. I think it's ZAttack proxy. Yeah. So basically, they define them in a plethora of tools, but one of their focal point is ZAP. And ZAP has an integration plugin for Jenkins. It's been released not too far ago, and it's already been, yeah, it's quite aggressively. So there were only 50 installs. Generally, when they actually abandoned it. So they had like a separate plugin for Jenkins, and then they moved to the new, completely new project on Jenkins plugins. So it's now currently being used about like 400 installs in the world, which is not bad for security. The idea behind it is that you are able to define a ZAP scan. I do actually, I'm not sure if I have a slide on it. Nah, I don't have a slide in it. But the idea is here, like, take a look at this one. You can define a site. You can define what type of, like, is it going to be like all header scan? Like, let's try to exploit all possible web server, like, vulnerabilities out there. Let's crunch it with a lot of header-related like blobs, for example, and see whether it crashes or not. Some client sessions, you can test your particular app from different paths, whatnot. It basically orchestrates your HTTP or HTTPS vulnerability scans, and it can simulate a total attack on conventional web servers. And after that, they just hook it into the pipeline of Jenkins, and as you see, the scan takes about like 30 seconds. So it's not a really long scan. If you run it on a beefed up container, and it's a container itself, it only takes like half a minute in the entire build process. There is also a very big set of different libraries that you can also tie into the Jenkins testing. They would test different servers, for example, Node.js, Rails, I guess I've seen here, RetireJS, and like many others. So basically, all these projects are there for you to test the app on your preferred IDE, or sorry, on your preferred framework, test it against the known current vulnerabilities. And there's a full list of it. So if you Google for awesome DevSecOps, you will be able to find this list of testing scripts. And okay, so this is what we've discussed. So once you created the criticality, the risk of your applications, start with the threat modeling. So like, is data going to be in the wrong hands? I've got 5 minutes, I know. So is data going to be in the wrong hands, or is going to be an accidental compromise or a brute force attack? And then based on this logic, expand it like whether it's going to be a human failure. So someone, for example, lost their laptop. And actually, losing a laptop has a special attention in here. Remember these magic tilde dots, right? Do not lose laptops, or use the Dell or whatever, the encryption of the SSDs, right? So please, like if you lose the laptop, there could be a lot of things in your tilde, so that's very dangerous, especially if you're using AWS. Now, where was it with the tree, right? And then, focus on code. So as early as possible, ensure that not MD5, but like SHA-256 is used if you use hashing or something like that. Ensure that the code repositories are private, not public, especially if you hard code the security artifacts into it. Make sure that the orchestration involves all the testing that we've discussed. There are many other cool things that I wanted to share. This is actually what I tried today. So on Shodan, it's like, as per like 3 p.m. We can actually do that, I think, if I have, Anyhow, so it was like 3 p.m. today. On Shodan, I looked at X Hudson response in the HTTP, and it basically is the project name for Jenkins. And I came up with at least like 5 Jenkins that are completely unprotected with passwords, like totally. So, and I logged into one of them, and it runs on AWS, and the guys actually run it in production. Like, there was like Arun Kumar, Deliva Kumar. I looked him up on LinkedIn. He's actually working for Tata Consultancy. And he was like, I never thought that it would be that easy. But yeah, please make sure that all these aspects are like reviewed at least twice a year, or as I propose, like every 2 months, return to them and sanity check. What's the security exposure? And so employees, GIS, who loves GIS? Love GIS, yeah, cool. Make sure when you publish the GIS, make sure it's at least not Google crawlable, okay? So like, so make it the problem of the crawler of the attacker, not at least as easy as in Google, right? And Slack tokens are there, AWS creds, as we discussed. Now, yeah, so, and yeah, the one good advice that I picked up for myself is like, Jenkins has to be segmented into, if you run it on AWS, it has to be in a like network ACL and a particular separate security group. It has to be segmented to only allow access from the known set of hosts. Like, this is really, for me, the core takeaway from like what I've seen today with this Jai Kumar example when I just logged into his Jenkins, right? And then everything should be all across authenticated. Please, please, please. So yeah, that's it. So I, again, like, I will probably pile it up in terms of like the links and everything. The short link is bit.ly/, I will update it with the latest format, bit.ly/docker-security. And there is about, like, I spent about like 15 or 20 hours just watching all these videos and going through these PDFs. It's a lot of cool material. Reach out to me on LinkedIn or ping me on Twitter if you guys have any ideas about security. I'll be happy to learn from you. That's a big area. We're not experts, so let's move on together. So just learn from each other. Yes.
Are you active in the DevSecOps meetups in Singapore?
Oh, no, not at all.
So there is a DevSecOps group in Singapore led by two security people. And they also did a DevSecOps conference back in February or so. So it's very interesting to be there on meetup.com as well.
Oh yeah, I would definitely look it up. Am I in the wrong room? No, it's just something that I appreciated, but it's just something that I needed I needed food for thoughts, and this is the way I just structure my thinking.
No, it's good to have it across.
Right. Cool. Guys, any questions? Yes, please.
Ever tried Polymers?
Say again?
Ever tried Polymers.com or the other one with the source cleaner? So you mentioned once or twice that you want your software tested. Polymers.com.
Vulners, as it like vulnerabilities?
Yeah, like vulnerabilities.
Okay.
Vulners.com. Wow, the website looks brilliant. Oh, nice landing page. So database,
the,
okay.
That one is a search engine for vulnerabilities in your package. So when you're saying that you want to have a security patent as a part of your CI/CD, as a part of your container building process, then what you could do potentially. You could actually scan through. They have an API, obviously. So what you would do, is you would scan through them or service like them, all packages which constitute, which participate in the build process before you actually build it. But you mentioned once or twice that have an auto calendar notification which doesn't scale.
Oh, sure.
What you could do is you just scan packages for non-vulnerabilities as a part of the build process, and because it's
sure.
An API, you can do it really easy.
I actually went just to correct myself. When I was saying about once in 2 months, I was saying reviewing the process, review the process of how we do security for the build. Not really, of course, not really checking it once in 2 months. It has to be every build. Vulnerable test targets. Vuln hub. Yeah, it's not in here. Definitely. Thanks for that. Take a look at it. And the second one you've proposed is source clear, right?
Yeah.
Source clear. Yeah. Thanks for these advices. All right. And I'll suggest an edit to these dudes as well. Cool. Any other questions? Yes, please.
Yeah, so from our experience, the name is Knock.
So, excuse me, what's the name of the project?
Knock. So it scans the open source, whatever you have deployed in your code, and then it contains a CVE database that will map all the vulnerabilities and the patches.
Help me spell it out.
B-U-C-K.
B-U?
Black as in black.
Black.
Duck. There's a Jenkins plugin for it, so that will automate the releases.
Black Duck software. All right. If you don't mind my asking, what sort of applications, what sort of language do you use it with?
Most of the applications that we have are Java and
Java. All right. Cool. Yeah, thanks for that. Nice one. I love it. Look at that. Nice website. All right, thanks for feedback.
In terms of like container security, there's Twistlock and Aqua Security. Twistlock. Yeah, Twistlock.
Excellent.
And Aqua Security. I think the like Twistlock is from Israel, and Aqua Security, I'm not sure. UK.
Are these companies are more likely to be startups, right? So they're not really long term in the industry. Twistlock and Aqua. Okay. Wow, look at that. That's like all these websites that are brilliant. It's called landing page. You can buy them on ThemeForest for $60. Cool. Thanks for that. Any other questions or suggestions for the list that we've covered today? Thank you. Thank you, guys.